And I know he watches over me. He watches over me.
December the 26th, 2002, and we have a very special occasion. We have all of the Stecky sisters here, starting with the oldest, Essie, Ola, Dot, and Ollie. And we're going to use this time that we have together for them to share some special moments and memories that they've had when they were growing up here in Dublin, Georgia. And we really look forward to it. This will become a part of our memoirs. It will become a part of a documentary for our family to pass on from generation to generation.
Okay.
I love you today because you cared for me in such a special way. That's why I praise you and I lift you up and I magnify your name. That's why my heart is filled with praise. My heart, my mind, my soul belongs to you. You paid the price for me way back on Calvary. That's why I praise you and I lift you up and I magnify your name. That's why my heart is filled with praise. That's why my heart is filled with praise. Oh, that's why my heart is filled with praise. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
Okay, look at all some of the little statues.
We're trying to figure out what thing it is.
It's December 26, 2002. And we have the four most precious women on God's green earth.
Here, here.
And we are so proud. And this is going to be such a special time. This is something that I've been wanting to do for several years, and the timing has never been right. And now everybody's here. Shut up, Sabrina.
I thought she was going to get you there.
Oh, she sure is.
Are you videotaping?
Okay, we want you all to start off. Well, you can introduce yourselves. Who are you now?
My name is Dorothy Stecky Pearson.
Who are you?
My name is Ola Stecky Cummings.
I am Essie.
You forgot who you were, huh? To share. And one that I want everyone to share is how Aunt Essie was always getting out of spankings.
Getting out of what?
Spankings. She didn't get in trouble because Grandmama knows loved her better than she loved y'all.
You got that right.
Let me tell you.
Because she was such a sweet lady. She really was. She was just so precious.
Now I see it.
And she was. She was just so precious. She would just take care of us and watch out for us. And when Mother Lee was in her care, she would spank us. So, you know, she would always spank us, and she would just, you know, do this. And then we knew we had to obey. But she really was. She was just precious. And I don't think my mother and father loved her anymore.
She did, though.
She did always give her the best of sweet potatoes. Make it have these strings, and she'd take my potato off my plate. She might get choked.
And what would we do with those string ones?
I eat them.
After a few tries, we got them down.
Water.
We wanted sweet potatoes and get you a lot of water.
A bucket that would sit on the shelf, and you know, we would go out there and we had to ease, if there wasn't any water in the bucket, you know, we had to ease the bucket way, you know, so that mother would hear the dipper, so that she wouldn't hear us hit the bottom of the bucket, you know, because if she hear that the dipper hit the bottom of the bucket, she said, go draw some water. Y'all go to the well and get some water. We didn't want to be the one to go and get the water, you know, so we just ease up, try to get us just a little bit of water out of it, you know. And then sometimes she'd say, May want some water. Y'all go to the
sick yesterday.
And I stayed at home.
And why they had to go to the field, you know, and they were trying to do everything they could to get me well. You know, and I would stay to the house
and she
I
refused
would,
to get well.
I would read the Bible. Daddy was so proud of me.
Oh, yes. That would make you up. Want to just.
Daddy, I read the whole Bible today.
And mother be combed her hair, she had pretty hair. What would daddy say?
Oh, that's smart baby. Read the whole Bible. That is good. I wanna just knock her out.
It should be sitting up in the bed.
And
put the bowl in the middle of the bed,
each braids, in two braids.
And have them brought down. Yeah, they were hanging all the way down. They were all the way down here. We can't figure out whether they were my sisters.
They don't sound like my sister.
Oh, well, you're so, tell me about them. How were they at Etsy?
Oh, they were naughty.
Naughty, naughty, naughty.
My mother would leave me in charge, you know. I said, now, if you don't do this, you know, don't do such a thing, you'd be naughty. I will tell Mother Dad. I will tell Mother Dad. They just show up, you know, all three of them. They just show up.
My mom's sister, I did.
No.
You did?
No,
I
did.
Oh.
Maybe I'm too old. Don't
back down. You said all three of them. Stick to what you said.
She didn't back down. You said that.
She back down on you. So yeah, you a daughter.
All of them were pretty naughty. They were. And I guess the only reason I wasn't naughty because I was left in charge. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And if I hadn't been left in charge, I'd been naughty too, I'm sure. But you know, children will be children. But when Mother and Dad would come home, I wouldn't tell them. So that was why they show out every time I really, you know, I really loved them and I didn't want them to get a spanking.
She was too sweet.
That's the truth. I really did not want them to get a spanking. So that was why I wouldn't tell my dad. So that's why they're like they are today. That's the reason they turn out the way they are. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I didn't tell them. If I had told them, oh, they would have gotten a spanking every time they were dead.
I remember when we came from, when we come from school, we were supposed to change our clothes and get ready to go to the field. And we had to go and pick beans, wasn't it? We were picking beans.
Cotton, I think. At what time?
Was we picking cotton or beans over there when we were up there at the
Longhouse? Uh-huh. I think we were picking cotton.
We were supposed to.
Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, we came home from school and we were back there because we had this huge kitchen and the dining room. And it had a pantry there. I just think, I even dream about that house, really. Mm-hmm. And it had a window.
A serving window.
And we were all back there in the kitchen and we were fussing, arguing, you know. And we couldn't call names, you know.
No.
But the little name that we would call was
Ugly Black Pants.
And we were back there fussing. Sister was sitting in the wood. And sister was sitting, she was kind of glitched dead. And she was standing on the side of that fender. And she was trying to make us hush, you know. And we just kept on.
Showing
out. Don't make me hush.
And after a while, all of us looked at that daddy was
just standing there in the window.
They froze. I tell you, they froze.
I have never been so scared.
They knew what was coming. They knew what they were going
to
get.
You didn't have to say anything.
They have to say anything.
Just one by one. Just yeah. Come on and
they didn't get you.
Go with your whip.
That's the only whip
that I heard. Look at your whip.
Oh, child, you got a whipping.
What did she say?
You say that's the only whipping you've ever remembered.
That's the only whipping I remember getting.
You leave.
What
is she standing for? Because you went into something all the time.
What do you mean I got whipped for?
Oh, yeah.
That's
the one I remember. That's the
from
one.
Daddy.
From daddy.
What did you whip you with?
They never went from mommy, didn't they?
Probably. And mother would make blackberry wine. You know, we pick blackberries and mother would make blackberry wine. And she'd put it up in the cabinet and hide it. And honey would slip out of the field, out of the cotton field. And she would always want to go get the water. Y'all thirsty? Y'all want some water? You know, we hadn't been out there long enough to want to get thirsty, you know. But she had to go home and get us some water.
She's trying to be helpful.
So she went home, and that mother had talked about the wine. Because Daddy had said, Mother had told Daddy, you know, I put the wine up there, and it doesn't look, you know, as strong as it did when I put it in there. And so Daddy said,
Excuse me for cutting you off, sister, but I didn't start with my telling on you all. Didn't I tell Daddy and Mother that you all had been drinking my wine?
Oh, yeah.
And Daddy told Mother.
Oh, time.
No, that devil is not. That nobody's calling that devil for wine.
She would give all of us a little bottle of wine.
But he called a conference. You know, people say famous for calling those conferences.
Granddaddy. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Really?
Conference after conference.
You better not act like you want to doze off.
So he questioned them about bothering
the baby's wine.
And nobody, they declared they had not bothered my wine. So Daddy told Mother after that, that devil is, nobody's bothering that devil's wine. He said, I bet you she's getting her own. Now, sister, that's where you drop me up.
Okay.
Now, drop it up today.
Go home to get the water. I'll go home and get some water because everybody's thirsty. When she would go home, she had to stack up some chairs up, you know, so she could get up in the top of the cabinet to get the wine. And she would get the wine and she'd drink some out of it and then put some water in it. Say, you know, my wine is really not looking as strong as it looks. She said, something is wrong here. So then that's when Daddy said, I know what's wrong. So that little devil, she's been wanting to go home to get water, and she's been going home and drinking up her own wine. And then she said, Daddy, sister knows been drinking up my wine. Sister knows drink my wine, and then pour the water in it.
He said, I proved it to him. Mother said, no. So that baby can't get up there and get that wine. Mm-hmm. He said, I prove it to you. So the next time they sent me to get water, Daddy followed me. And he watched the whole process. Told Mother. Never said a word to me about it until I was way grown.
Oh, really? Really?
They just let me continue to do it. they were telling it one day, and Cunley said, well, they should have whipped her. That's what they should have done.
And speaking of wine, she could drink a gallon and it wouldn't get drunk.
A whole gallon.
How much could you drink that?
One day, Mom and Daddy went to town. And my name is Zip. I'm going to get some wine, and I don't want you to tell. They kept it up in the loft, you know. You have to go up in the loft to get the wine. She went up there in the loft, and she got the wine. And boy, she was just a cricket. And so I was just looking at her. She had put just a little bit in a glass for me. And she said, good, drink this. I said, I don't want it. She said, you drink it. She's always real bossy, you know. It was just a little bit, and I drank that little bit of wine, you know. Boy, I just got so high. And she got so angry with me. I didn't have but a swallow, and you're going to be drunk and mother not be able
to do it. She's going to crush my dick. Because she can't handle this stuff.
Everything she could to sober me up before mother and dad got back home. And she had already had a gallon of it. Still walking straight.
She didn't take the time to watch that the daddy didn't swallow. He didn't swallow the juice once he chewed the tobacco. The fun was to chew the tobacco and
chew that.
See how far you could send it. And she learned that part.
And she knew how to do all of it. Chew it, smoke it. Oh, she could pop it. She could do it all. None of it neither.
Oh, and when Mother Nose got home, oh boy, was she sick. She was, that poor baby was sick.
And they didn't know
what they didn't know what.
Did you chew some tobacco too?
I probably didn't, because I didn't do it.
She chewed. It didn't bother her. She chewed.
Well, tell us what about the cake story, too.
Oh, the cake. Oh, when Dot was, the sister and sis, apparently, where were they? They were not at home.
You bought the cake that Mother made?
I was the one chasing Dot.
You were chasing Dot?
I was chasing Dot, trying to catch her. You were chasing too. I was chasing.
So both of us
were not ready. Both of us were. And that was so, but I couldn't run fast because I was so too.
It was just so funny to me.
Just
but they baked this cake. And I said, Mother said, she's going to cut it. And I said, oh, no, you're not cutting this cake. I said, I am getting me a piece of this cake. I didn't see that little bonnet's going up.
It's a big house, you know.
And she was,
no, that was a long house.
That was a long house.
That was a long house.
And she
would get to the corner.
Uh-huh.
And she would stop.
And look back
and back and laugh.
Take off again.
She got this whole cake.
Running around the whole cake.
So all you can see was those little bow legs turning.
She didn't drop that cake.
No, she didn't drop it.
Moved around that house, man. Long house as fast as she could go, but she had that cake. She was still holding that cake.
Well, I know what Mom used to talk about. You and Ola, she would talk about, you know, she always said how sweet you are. She said, you would not believe how Ola was when she was small with children. You remember that? With
oh,
Ola?
Goodness, yes. There was a little second cousin of ours named Skeezy. Geneva,
our cousin
Geneva's grandson.
Oh, was that Geneva's son?
Was that Geneva's son?
Skeezy? Wasn't it Skeezy?
Yes, that's
son,
Geneva's
right?
Son.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's okay, son. Geneva's son mm-hmm. came down to spend the summer with us. And the little boy was crazy about sis. And she just
he
kept
was
him
so
crying. He was, because he was naughty too. But Mother told Sis to put the pillows, ever so often we would have to put the pillows out on the banister to sun, to freshen them up, fluff them. Mm-hmm. And every time Sis would lay the pillows on the banister, Skeezy would knock them down. She would put them up. I don't know how did she get back at Skeezy? But she kept the poor baby crying all the time. And there was a girl who went to elementary school with us, Charlie Mae Johnson.
She had a flat nose,
hot kind of like that. She was so crazy about Old May.
She loved her.
And Sis used to just call her names. That nosy. Hey,
Mama got a nerve talking about me with Darlene.
The nerve of her. Oh. And if we see Charlie Mae today, the first thing that's going to come out of her mouth.
Old May. We were downtown together and trying on clothes. And we were in there just having fun, laughing. and Tyler Baby was in the next booth. You remember that?
Uh-huh. Sure
and
do.
She said, she said, Ola Mae.
she heard your voice.
She just loved it. She just really loved it. She just loved it. All she was just devilish.
She was so devilish.
She got a bad habit of running from mother. When mother got ready to spank her, she had a bad habit of running from her. Mm-hmm. Oh, mother stopped that. Oh, yes, she did. She took out across the field. That's the time, mother. I guess mother said, "Sister Carol, I am gonna run with you today." Sis and mother. That's number one. That's number two. Finally, when mother caught that young lady all out of breath. She, whatever energy she had left, she got it.
That's the last time. I will never run again.
I've been so sorry for her. Mother beat her good.
Oh, yes, she did. So hey, do you remember what you got that beating about?
What?
You don't remember? You said, "You like sister better than you do the rest of us anyhow."
Just say, "Hi, sweetheart, hi." After a while, the baby starts screaming, "Yeah!" she has pinched the baby. She's tired of the baby, wanting mama to take the baby back.
And then she
what's the man? Yeah. What's the man? Sorry if I win the baby. I'm going to go back to your mommy.
She was so devilish.
But I can't remember what happened with those pillows with Skeezy. I just, you remember him doing that.
I remember him doing that. But I can't remember what happened with him. Y'all can't remember anything else? Y'all's memory is that short?
It is. But that was the bossy one over there. She was so bossy.
Aunt Ollie.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And she would always... She wanted me to be the baby, you know. And when we would go out, everybody would think, because I was sweet and quiet. Mm-hmm. And but she was fast and bossy, you know. Mm-hmm. And everybody would say, we'd be walking together, and they'd say, which one of you all the oldest? And before I could open my mouth, and she said, I am. She's the baby. She always said that. And we would be downtown sometimes, and we would go into those expensive stores like Don's, you know, Stevens, and we didn't have a penny, you know, we didn't have any money, but we Ollie would just go in there and she put on all these fine clothes, you know, trying on all these fine clothes and hats and looking in the mirror and turning around and clearly just waiting on it. Well, how do you think that look? Does that fit nice? Do you like the way they have it? I don't know. Something about this I don't like. She'd just be turning around in the mirror, you know. And I'd be just standing there. I said, you better come on so we can go home, but you know you don't have any money. And she didn't even pay me any attention. Just standing up there, you know, trying on. Maybe I'll try on that one over there. Bring that coat over there. I said, oh, this girl. And when we went to Albany State, she always thought that she should protect me rather than my protecting her. We'd be walking on campus and...
Well, you were ill-equipped to protect yourself.
What does that mean?
Boy, she didn't walk. She would not...
She wasn't worldly enough.
She would not let anybody bother me. And she better not hear of anybody, you know, bothering me in no way. Mm-hmm. Okay, at that particular time in 48 when we were in school, at that time, all of the light-skinned people thought they were the elect. Mm-hmm. They were superior over the darker ones, mm-hmm. because, you know, there was, we had a lot of black ones, but we didn't have that many, you know, light real ones. Light ones, you know. And they thought, you know, we were kind of under them. Mm-hmm. So come time to select someone for most beautiful. Most beautiful.
Homecoming queen. Wasn't
the
homecoming queen?
It was most beautiful.
Most beautiful.
I was the most beautiful.
I said,
you don't believe it, I'll show you the book. Seriously, I was truly not the most beautiful. There was one Mexican girl, and she was so pretty. But then there was a little click there, you know, these light-skinned, you know, they were all going together, and they would just hardly speak to us. But then come time to vote, you know, they wanted to speak to all of the black ones, you know, so they can vote for this prettiest girl, which mm-hmm. was really the prettiest. She was a beautiful girl. And all the black ones got together and said, she's not going. They are above us, better than us. She's not going. And I said, mm-mm, they need to vote for me. And I said, no. I said, no, don't you all vote for me. And Holly said, yes, they're going to vote for you, but she wasn't even in my class. Yes, they are going to vote for you. She said, Mother and Dad cannot afford a gown. I said, so I don't want them to vote for me. And she Holly said, we'll borrow one from somebody. So that Miss Fassie got around and borrowed a gown from somebody after they voted, and they did vote me in.
I was a campaign manager.
they were blacks, and they were, I don't know, they were so excited, you know, about my, I really wasn't, you know.
But this child was beautiful. But just because of that, you know, in those days, they would look on the light ones as being superior, you know.
Brainwashing.
So that was because of that girl. Because if it hadn't been, I was not going to let them. I said, oh, you're not going to do it. And she steps in, not even in our class. She steps in, oh, yes, she'll be it. She's going to be there.
We're glad she did it.
You deserved it. You deserved it. Yes, that's
for sure. Did you all experience a lot of racism in those?
What day
this
is?
When you were growing up. You are a kid, ain't that the truth?
What day is?
What day is it?
What today is?
Well, you know, I think about it because when we were growing up, although we were, you know, we didn't expect, mommy knows, we talked about this, we were very much sheltered from a lot of that. I guess because, see, our lives were centered out here. And at home and at school, and we really didn't experience a lot of racism like that was going on all around us. So I was wondering, did you all?
Actually, we didn't. No. Probably because, I don't know, because of our parents, I suppose. Mm-hmm. They interacted very well with them white folks.
They really did.
And they respected daddy and mother. They had a lot of respect from black and white. Mm-hmm. So if mother and daddy needed, they were there. And if they needed, mother and daddy were there. Mm-hmm. So we really did not.
We really did. Because even at the Hogs, when we were living on the Hogs, they always respected us.
Yes, mm-hmm. they did.
Mm-hmm. And then on the Garners, they have always been very close.
And even I really believe that
like
was family members.
Even now with Dr. Garner, you know, Dr. Garner feels that real close to us because of his grandparents. Mm-hmm.
Because of Dad, he said Dad taught him as a little boy how to hunt.
Right, Dad used to take them hunting.
I was in the doctor's office, in Dr. Garner's office one day. And when he comes in the office, if either one of us is there for him to see, he'll hug us, you know. Mm-hmm. And the nurses look, you know, just mm-hmm. look at him, you know. And he looked up one day and said, oh, their daddy helped raise me. Mm-hmm. That's what he told me. Mm-hmm. Their father helped raise me. Mm-hmm. And of course, his grandfather, Rob Garner, was really a blessing to Big Mama. Mother's mother. She lost her husband. And, she was carrying her last child like a bird. And after she lost her husband, Dr. Garner's grandfather would really, really helped Big Mom a lot. He would send his hands over to her place.
You might need to tell him what hands our sister would be getting.
He would send his plow hands,
his
workers over to take care of his farm.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Uh-huh. Because see, there was only
all those girls.
She had all the girls. And of course, she was carrying a bird when her father passed, and there were only girls. So Mr. Rob Garner would send his workers over to Big Mama's farm. And they would just do everything that needed to be done. So that, because Big Mama only had girls, so that they wouldn't have to do it. So, and Big Mama told me that he would tell her all of the time, whatever you need, don't suffer for anything. Whatever you need, just send one of the children over and tell me what you need. And she said he would send her whole hams at a time.
Wow.
Anything she needed, he would send it to her. And of course, there were a lot of white folk who were nice to her.
because she didn't have a husband. And actually, we got along just like family. I mean, real family.
That's true. I really believe they just, I mean, they loved us. Mm-hmm. Because I remember when I was home, and Daddy was sick. And my daddy was very sick. When was that? 87. 87. 87, and I was out there in clothes. I was hanging clothes out there in line, and Mr. Garner came, and he said, I want to know, it was one of the Garners, he said, I just want to know how Saul is really getting along. And I said, he said, I heard that he's not doing too well. I said, he really is. And I said, he is not doing too well. And you know, he just stood there and just cried.
So which one? I don't know which one it was.
But he stood there.
It might have been Ryan.
You know, and I just felt the love, you know.
Yeah, well, they really were. I mean, you could feel that they weren't putting on.
Right.
I mean, they really did love. They really did love us. They cared. Mm-hmm. And they were concerned that we were not in need. We were never in need for anything. And they were very, very kind. Amen. Very kind and sweet to us.
Sure.
And I will always be grateful to them for it.
And speaking of gratefulness, you all, let's sing. I'm so grateful. Y'all
that's
sing.
A long pitch.
I'm pretty grateful. God has spared me another day.
Sisters, God has blessed us all to hit 80.
Very close.
So
very close.
Knocking on the door.
But we are mighty thankful. We are mighty grateful.
The beautiful family that we have, so grateful for our beautiful children, our beautiful grands, our beautiful greats.
Spared us to bless all of you to get grown on your own.
Just lots to be grateful for.
Amen.
So thankful.
So grateful. Even from childhood, you know, I'm reminded of all that, like in Sunday school, you know, we'd be discussing, you know, about how the hard times we had when we were growing up. But I just can't say that we had any hard times, really hard times, you know. We never had the plow. A lot of women had the plow, but Daddy would not let us do that, you know. And
he,
we just
he let me
plow. You know.
She wanted to do everything.
We were, and we were always able to give others. So just have that tree, had an oak tree under there, just had all kind of vegetables under there. He would just come by and give them. And I'm just so thankful for my childhood, you know, that my parents, you know, that just brought us up and
in a Christ-like
way. Just said he always told us in all thy ways acknowledge him, trust in it, and he will direct our path, and he certainly will. He will always keep his promises, and I'm just so thankful for that. So thankful for all my family here. I tell you, it's just so such a blessing just to be here together.
I'm so grateful for our roots.
Yes.
Daddy and Mother taught us it's more blessed to give than to receive.
Oh, yes.
And they gave.
They did.
Whatever we made on the farm, we go out early in the morning picking peas, butter beans, whatever, and we have it all under the oak tree there, and people will come by and Daddy will give it away. What's that expression about you go your hand is so tight until nothing can
go in,
nothing can get in or nothing can get out. So they were always giving.
Caring and giving people.
So we were blessed.
Loving people.
Well, we have about 2 minutes left on this tape. So what would you all like to share before we put in another one?
Oh yes, this is I'd just like to say that, and just repeat that we're so blessed to have been born to beautiful parents. They loved us very much, and they brought us up in a Christ-like way. And of course, we are thankful that we turned out the way we did.
Let's hear a song from another song from Hot Top.
Y'all think of a song that we can sing in a song.
The Blood.
Okay, let's sing All the Blood. You remember that one?
You remember that?
All the blood of Jesus.
Questions that they would like to ask their aunts. And so we'd like for them to share some of their thoughts or some things that they would like to know about their aunts and their grandparents when they were growing up.
As long as they don't get too personal.
Okay, Marnita, do you want to start off the group? Is a question you'd like to ask? And who are you?
Oh, I'm Marnita McGregory, and that's one of my older cousins. I wanted to know,
A little bit louder, baby.
All I wanted to know was, parenting harder now than it was back then when they were growing up?
Did you have anybody in particular you wanted to answer, or just anybody?
Do you consider parenting hard now? Hard now? It's pretty easy now. So it's a pretty easy job for your mommy, right?
Yeah.
Well, parenting back then, 100 years ago, was probably a little easier for the simple reason that we were not, we didn't have as much at our disposal as you guys have now. But had we had as much at our disposal as you guys have, that probably wouldn't be a bit of difference.
Break it down so I don't know what I mean.
You know what I mean? Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sure, she knows what I mean. It's the
Okay, Jazzy.
This is for a girl at Pearson. Can you tell us a time you got in trouble and what did you do and what was your punishment? Girl, I never got in trouble.
I think she answered it.
when I was growing up, I got in trouble quite a bit. I'm sure my sisters would tell you that mother and daddy did not allow us to fuss with one another. We had to get along without fussing and caring. We never fought. Fighting was out of the question. We didn't even fuss with one another. But when we go to bed sometimes, and Ollie would be putting her feet on mine, trying to get hers warm, and I'd be pushing hers away, and I said, stop, don't do that, if I get loud, and Dad would hear us, and he said, do I hear you all in there? And if she continued to do it, and then I said, don't do that. And then that was just it. My daddy would get up and boy, and he would just tear us up. He would just get me, he would get her too. He would get both of us because he did not allow any fussing, I got spankings about fussing. That's one of the times that I got spankings. We got spankings. I was, on a whole, very good girl.
Oh, my. In other words, the time she got in trouble, it was my fault. She was just lying there, all nice and sweet.
That's pretty much the truth, though. She was the devil in the family.
She was the naughty one in the family, and bossy too.
I believe it.
Does that answer?
EJ, you got a question, man?
EJ hasn't told who he is, has he?
My name is Everson Jordan.
Who's your mom?
Serena Jordan. And my grandmother is Miss Pearson.
And your papa?
And my papa is Mr. Pearson. And this goes to Grandma Pearson. Tell us about great-grandmother and great-grandfather.
Oh, well, I have a cute one to tell about grandmother. when grandmother was real sick, and you were about three years old. And grandmother was on her walker, and she was coming out of the bathroom, and she just was making it. She was coming out of the bathroom, and Everson was a little boy, and he got out there in the middle of the floor, and he said, "Come on, grandmother, come on. You can make it. You can make it. Come on, grandmother." I thought that was just too cute.
Oh,
he just kept
that
up for so long. "Come on, grandmother. You can make it. You can make it." And grandmama just laughed. Great grandmama just laughed. She just laughed. She thought that was too cute. You did too.
It was the joy of my life.
And grandmama, your grandmama, great-grandmama and your granddaddy just loved all of you. Oh, they both just loved all of you. Loved you all. It's so precious. And this grandmama thinks that all of you are so precious, too.
Well, you know, that's a question all of you all could respond to about grandmama and granddaddy. Tell them about grandmama and granddaddy.
I know we've already done that.
They didn't hear you.
They can listen to the tape later.
I like the story of how grandmama and granddaddy met. Would one of you share that? Well, not how necessarily how they met, but I think one time they went out on a date and came home.
That's a good
no
late.
Such thing as dates.
Oh, nah.
What was it?
She wasn't even allowed to receive company. And mother knew that. Daddy knew that. But he was
daddy-ish like.
So this particular day, Sunday afternoon, Dad was going to walk Mother, not partly home, all the way home.
Which was not allowed.
She wasn't even supposed to be with him. Anybody else, as far as that goes. So they walked on to the house, and Bing Mama's house had a long porch and a swing and chairs. And Bing Mama was sitting on the porch when Daddy and Mother arrived. And so Bing Mama didn't smile very much. She spoke what she meant what she said in few words. And as they approached, Bing Mama said to Mother, "Okay, young lady, I thought I told you that you were not to be courting, not having any little boys walk you anywhere. So you just come right on in here and get your whipping." And my daddy stepped forward and said, "Mrs. Hughes, I will take her whipping for her." My grandmama said, "Okay, young man, you little managed rascal." Just step right up. My daddy said, "When that old woman got there, I knew I had been whipped." He said, "But I vowed that I would not cry." But she tore me up. And after that, I guess she gave in. She decided, you know, if he has that much courage, let him come on. So that's how it started.
Do you remember how old they were?
About 16.
About 16.
It was only 3 months difference in their ages. Mm-hmm. 16,
17.
So that answered you guys' question. Tiffany, you want to know how old you should be before you get a boyfriend? So about 16, I think.
At least.
At least.
15?
Yeah.
Well, you know. Do you have a question you would like to ask, Tiffany?
Hello, my name is Tiffany Person Kilgore. I'm the daughter of Gwendolyn Person Kilgore and Ricky Kilgore. I'm the granddaughter of Mrs. Pearson and Mr. Pearson. And Grandmom, or all of you, I'd like to ask you a question. How did you all get one?
well.
That well out there.
Mm-hmm. That well out there. Mm-hmm. And we had a pail that we had to tie a cord to it and put it down in there.
And also, I have another question. Can you tell us about your favorite Christmas one?
My favorite Christmas?
One of your favorite Christmas ones.
Oh, when I was growing up? Well, can you think?
My favorite probably was that Christmas when Daddy decided this is my last time. This is my last time playing Santa Claus.
Well, most of them were favorite for us because when we were growing up, we didn't get a lot of fruit, candy, and like you all can get it. Like every day is Christmas for you all. Yeah. Every day was not Christmas for us. When we got Christmas come, we got candy, all the fruit that we wanted, mm-hmm. and all of the sweets and whatnot. Yes. That was very special for us. So that was Christmas. That was very special for us. But one of the Christmases that I remember, and in fact, it was our last Christmas that they played Santa Claus for. And we wouldn't let them know that we knew who Santa Claus was, because Santa Claus was the one that come down the chimney and bring the toys and the food and all the stuff. So this particular Christmas, you know, and my daddy and mother, they would hide their toys and food and whatnot in a barn. And then when we go to sleep that night, then they would go, my daddy would have to go out there and put all this stuff in a sack. And then he comes in, you know, because all of my stuff slept in the same room that mother and dad slept in. So when they thought that we were asleep, then that's when we had our boxes all put out, you know, for them to put our stuff
around
in.
Fireplace.
Right by the fireplace. Mm-hmm. So dad went out to get the fruit, and mother had been telling dad all the time. Dad was telling mother. He said, those devils, he was calling us devils. Those devils know what Santa Claus is. And mother would say, no, they don't, saw. They don't know what Santa Claus is. They don't know what Santa Claus is. Oh, yes, they do. Yes, they do. They know what Santa Claus is. So we had this particular night, and it was real cold in December, you know, very cold. It was big fire going and everything. All in myself had to cover all over our head, pretending that we were asleep, you know. And then here come, and daddy goes out and get this sack, and he had this big sack on his back, and he was coming in the room, and he almost fell. And it's, you know, he stumbled. And he said, oh, my goodness. He said, Santa Claus about to break his tail. And I was saying, hush, Saul, hush. You will wake up those children. Hush, Saul, hush. He said, I'm telling you, Luke, he called him Luke. He said, I'm telling you, Luke, this is my last time going out there in that cold, because those devils know what Santa Claus is. This is my last time going out there. Then I saw, they don't know. They be quiet, Saul, be quiet. Mother got up out of the bed, you know, hauling myself under the cover,
before,
just sniggling.
Before that night, mm-hmm. Daddy started playing
with the dolls.
He was making the dolls cry. Uh-huh. Mother was trying to quiet
make
him.
You're going to wake those kids up.
Mm-hmm. You feels not stupid anyhow. You show the dolls or whatever, and they would just cry. He wanted to make sure that he wouldn't get, that was his last dollar.
But anyway, we got up early that morning, you know, and we was, oh, look, my Santa Claus brought us, oh, a doll, and we were playing with the doll. Oh, we were so happy over all our stuff, and he brought us this, and all I said, and oh, Santa Claus brought me a pair of socks, and I was looking at enough of my socks, and I couldn't find my socks.
Always looking at my stuff.
Always. And I said, Mother, y'all didn't put me no socks in there. Mother said, what did you say, Gail? I said, Santa Claus didn't bring me no socks. And Dad said, what'd I tell you, Luke? Didn't I tell you they already knew about Christmas? So I messed it all up, you know, by saying know, Santa Claus. My dad said he wasn't going out there in that cold anymore.
Every night we would have Bible study, and we would have to keep our eyes open, and we would have a long lecture, and we have to listen to it. And particularly if we did anything wrong, you know, he would just go on and on from Genesis to Revelation, you know, talking about the Bible. Okay, and then that morning we would get up early that morning, you know, if it wasn't a school day, and we go and to the field, and we work until dinner time, and then we come back home, and then we eat dinner, and we have about a rest, an hour of rest, and after that we would go back to the field, and we would work until the sun go down, then we come back home, and we would eat and get our bath and go to bed and get up and do the same thing over and over. That's when you did.
And pray for rain.
You have to go back, you know, the next day.
That's the way our day when we were growing up.
We worked untiringly. We worked.
Dancing has a question.
We worked untiringly.
That's what I thought she said.
yes, we did.
Jazzy.
This is for Aola. What was your first line?
First occupation, nurse.
My first that I really got paid for, I worked on a doctor right up here. I babysat for a doctor and his wife at the VA hospital. And that was my very first job. But I got many wages for.
Another time I substituted for you.
Back to Mrs. Crosby.
Oh. She sent me a picture of all her kids.
All of them were fun.
Fond memories, you know, just family being together, you know, praying together and having dinner together before we pray. Bible study together, and they were all just fond memories, just being together with family. They were just fond memories.
And we were taught to love and respect each other. First of all, love and respect our parents, and love and respect our sisters, and we were not allowed to fuss with each other. No fussing at all. We were punished severely by just fussing at each other. So we learned to love each other, not fuss. Well, you know, we fuss behind the back, but we couldn't let them catch us, because if they caught us, then we were really punished.
When it was back then, did y'all make a lot of money?
Oh, yes. No, we did not. We didn't make a lot of money like
I heard you spent it.
She was a thrifty spender, that little that she had. And I think she still is, isn't she, brother?
Oh.
She's talking about thrifty spenders back then. Yeah, and I was saying that your wife was thrifty then, and I was wondering if she's still thrifty. Spend it. It's okay for you to speak.
Am I on camera? No. Oh, yes, she is thrifty. Very thrifty. Too thrifty.
Candy, don't.
Joy, and what's the...
Who is your mama?
Toshima.
And who's your second mama?
Mommy too.
What's her name?
Cassandra.
Okay.
Now your question.
Was the pond that little? I mean that big.
What she means, Uncle Brian? What she means?
Was the pond always the size it is now?
Yes.
Yeah, ever since we've had it, it was that big.
Oh.
Oh, you mean Joy? You mean when we were growing up?
Right.
Right? Oh, okay. We didn't have the pond when we were growing up.
Where did you all fish? Because grandmother loved to fish.
Grandmother would fish in streams and rivers. Wherever there was a spot of water, she might think there was a fish. She would fish.
So who put the pond out here?
The people from whom we bought the property, the Lovitz.
So when they bought the pond, y'all was living here, and did you have to pay to use it?
No. My mother could use it anytime she chose. And her children, and son-in-laws.
That was when you were grown. When you were growing up, it was not here.
Have you all always been so close?
Oh, we're getting pretty close now. Yeah, we usually sat very close to each other. You know, it's Tiffany.
Yes, Tiffany, we have. It's always been a very closely knitted family, and I just pray that we will always continue to be a close-knitted family, and I pray that you all, the next generation and the next generation and the next generation, will be the same as we are. Close.
Amen. Oh,
yes.
We're
back close to you.
Sandy requested
actually,
a song from you all, too.
Actually, Tiffany, I've always been able to every one of my sisters. Anytime I needed them, they were there.
I'll be there.
I'll be there. That's right.
Pray for the kids
they were
the
always
song.
Say amen for me, too.
Yes, always. And my sisters, my brothers, too.
That's right. And my brother, too.
And one thing I'd just like to say, when we were growing up, today, when we were growing up today, you know, children today, when you ask them to do something, they might kind of frown or might take the show and attitude like they don't want to do what you ask them to do. But we weren't allowed to do that, and we weren't allowed to just wait. When we are asked to do something, we're supposed to do it right then.
Excuses.
So you had to always try to have a positive attitude about things.
Yeah, because they would knock you into next month. Instead of they roll your eyes and tell you to do something. All they had to, you know, sit up in church. All they had to, you know, kids sit in church today. And you tell them, they're telling them to stop, you know, and look at you like. But all dad and mother had to do was just
I'm gonna again to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Mama gave it to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
Right, they are not very bright. I'm about the brightest one here.
What do you think about that one?
Think about what?
She's the brightest one here.
Intelligent one. Yes, she is. She's a smart young lady. Yes, and we're just thankful.
It's impossible to see, but God is gonna work it out if you just be. A child worried. or what it holds, but since we're always in a hurry just to see what each day will unfold.